Please note these are a form of social commentary and not in any way meant to put down the ideas and ideals. Of any political or gender identity. Please note these are a form of social commentary and not in any way meant to put down the ideas and ideals of any political or gender identity. You are all fair game in the eyes of the wicked, and we see you. Here we go. Here we go. Here we go. Here we go.
Oh shit! Pickle Rick! Motherfucker!
You are now watching Useless Gaming. STS.
Because it leads to the future. Not a future that will be, but one that might be. This is not a new world. It is simply an extension of what began in old ones. It has patterned itself after every dictator who has ever planted a written imprint of boot on the face of history since the beginning of time.
Dog will hunt.
Fuck, suck, and eat butt.
Welcome to the desert of the real.
Alrighty.
Please.
And that is how you start a show, man. How's it going, my party people? Alright, so, yeah. Took a little bit of a couple day break. Needed it. So, all right. So, what is new with you guys? Hopefully, everything's good. As you can tell, I have not gotten new headphones yet because I'm a complete lazy person. So, as you can see, this thing's still hanging out. Oh well, we're just gonna keep going with the show. All right. So, welcome to another episode of STS. I am your host, Useless Agent. If you know me from TikTok, you might know me as Mexibam, but just call me Guy. All right. So today we're going to be talking about a couple of different things. We're going to be talking about the overload of entertainment that seems to be kind of putting us in a chokehold with too much entertainment, where most of it really isn't that entertaining. I wanted to talk about that, but I also wanted to dip in before the show ends. I hope I can get to this. I really wanted to mention the system in itself, the entertainment system as a whole, and especially with the movie industry. Now, with the movie industry giving us so many, flops and no new ideas, and then where'd everybody go? I lost everybody already. Jesus Christ, haven't even started the show yet. All right, so anyway, I guess it is that I wasn't pretty enough or something. So anyway, as I was stating before, that we're at a point of an entertainment overload. And what I just don't find fair is that if these big fat cats in Hollywood want us so badly to watch their content, and they don't want us to see it on a streaming network, they don't want us to pirate it, and it's like, okay, well, how about A, make tickets more affordable? Because I don't know if you noticed, but Americans are pretty goddamn broke. And we don't have the money to be going to theaters every week anymore. It's just not, it's not in our lifestyles anymore. And, you know, the entertainment system has made it this way. The industry has gotten us to this point. So if you want us to return, I think you owe us. So I'll get to that in a little bit. So let's go ahead and start off with our ritual, and then I'll go ahead and begin. That's crazy to start off with so many people and lose so many right away. I mean, like, the instant I told them what this is going to be about, I guess the title right up here wasn't enough. I mean, I'm literally saying what it's going to be about. But that's cool. This is a thinking person show, so I don't mind when certain people don't come. I don't mind if you're going to ignore the show. I really don't care. what I do want is that if you're going to watch the show, that you would at least, you know, you get something out of it. You know, I don't care if you don't want to text in the box. I don't care if you don't want to be seen. If you want to stay on, keep your anonymity, go right ahead. But I'm going to do my show regardless. And whether I see 25 people on that little clicker or 2 million or just one or zero, I don't care. I'm going to keep doing this because I love doing this. So let's go ahead and start off with what I was talking about. Now, let's start off with Netflix. The name Netflix used to be synonymous with the destruction of Blockbuster. They had the mail-in system with their DVDs, eventually creating the stream giant and behemoth company that we see it as today. With so many competitors, we are at we're at a nexus of the universe where we're at an entertainment overload, where if we stop making any sort of content right now, if we all just stopped, you still wouldn't be able to watch all of the content available in this world. If you had a dozen lifetimes to live, you probably wouldn't go through all of it. I think I read somewhere that YouTube can get as many as 2,000 uploads within a minute. So, you know, that's going to be a lot. So when it comes to the big names like HBO Max or Disney Plus, you know, out comes this sludge of everything that has bounced against the wall, and we get to watch it in real time now. It's hard to come up with an intricate plot now when your work is constantly being dismantled halfway through the filming process. So by the time post wraps up, the movie has become something totally different and convoluted and probably stupid than what you originally came up with. And it's amazing how many shows or how many movies are completely dismantled in the post-production. So where the actor has to come back to do a bunch of different post-work. And I can understand their frustration, dude. We spent 6 months doing this, and now you're telling me you're going to come back a year later to do this again? I don't even remember how the character acted. So I try to see it from an actor standpoint as well as a fan. And from an actor standpoint, I can totally see why this would be a problem. Let's say I'm hired to play Jimi Hendrix. You know, let's just say it. All right. So if I'm hired to play Jimi Hendrix and I want to be as honest as possible on the portrayal of one of the greatest guitarists who ever lived. So I would want it to be as honest as possible, and I would want it to be as real as I can be, as much like him, like I would talk like him or keep his mannerisms. Now the movie is finished. I'm done with that. And now I got to go play Superman. Now that's a totally different character. I have to learn new mannerisms and kind of gain some new habits. And as you're doing that, to come back to a role that you've already let go of and you're already into the habits of a new character, it must be very difficult to just suddenly go back to the other character. Because, hey, I had months to train on that, and now I have no investment in it because we finished. So what's the deal? so I can see that. And The big shows that are on streaming networks offer such odd choices in programming now, seeing as I have no clue who these shows are made for. I'm not sure what they're trying to accomplish or what the fan base is. And as a fan, I have to believe there's some sort of method to this. But the big new shows on streaming networks are offering such weird things. Shows like Slippin' Jimmy and Dahmer, the countless Marvel bait and switch character series that they just keep trying. But then there is, you know, Velma, Slippin' Jimmy, She-Hulk, Ratchet, The Great North, and fucking Slippin' Jimmy again. All right, I'm sorry. Who are these shows for? Yeah, I am a absolute Breaking Bad and Better Call Saul fanatic. I love the storyline, but, you know, there's nothing I can say that hasn't been said, which is why I don't do episodes on them, because, you know, there's nothing I can add that hasn't already been said better than I could say it. So, you know, there's a great line in the movie American History X where he says he likes to end his, Derek always told his brother to end his stories with a quote, since someone out there has already said what you wanted to say, but better. So why bother? Just go with the good one. So I'm the same way when it comes to that. So being this huge fan of the series and the universe, I have nothing to add, because they know how genius they are. You know, the fact that everybody on that show was given a SAG award and yet the Emmys didn't give them anything, it just shows the politics and the totem pole. And so my question again is who are these shows designed for? You know, I would think, as a fan, from my very limited experience and my very limited knowledge of the entertainment industry as a whole, as an outsider, I would think every show has not only been set up to please a certain age demographic, but is even thought of beforehand. But if I were just born yesterday, I would think these shows are simply aimless, unsure of themselves. The writing bounces from genres to genres with nothing more than to stick to anything, you know, throwing shit against the wall and seeing what sticks. This is not sticking, okay? And I'm a huge fan of this fucking thing, including the El Camino movie. I love Better Call Saul. I think I almost love it more than Breaking Bad sometimes. But, I'm not a person that'll compare emotion. So the El Camino edition and Better Call Saul editions only made the show gain 1,000,000,000% more depth and replay value, making the film nerd like myself staring at every single item on screen, pausing different settings so I can look at every color. Their color palettes were gorgeous. And I analyze the color of an object, a simple little object. Now I have to study the color of the object. Why is he holding it? Where does it place itself within the scene? The camera angles are genius. They remind me of like Sam Raimi and his classic Evil Dead camera angles and aspect ratios. This show opens up, now I'm talking about Slippin' Jimmy now. This show opens up with, I don't know, an honest portrayal of what type of humor to expect for the entirety of the episode. So at least it starts off honestly, because this is all you're going to get. And the jokes fall flat with that over explanation gag humor where the character charmingly says something totally cliche and then explains the reference. And it's that, like, I don't know, it's that wannabe Paul Rudd style humor back when it was actually funny. And if you'd ask me, I think that started off with Bob Newhart. He was the first person I ever seen that could make the delivery of a joke completely change just with some stutters. But he was brilliant at that. The characters are a mixed blend of the characters from the actual series. For instance, there's Marco. Marco plays a heavy role in this. I don't know why. And it's just really strange to watch this because you know, if you're a fan of the series, you know how Breaking Bad ends, but you also know how, you know, Marco dies in like the first season, I think, of Better Call Saul. He dies pretty damn fast, and it's pretty sad how he dies. So for those of you that don't watch the show, go watch the show. Please watch the show. It's a great show. Better Call Saul and Breaking Bad are two shows that, and The El Camino, the whole universe is just brilliant. But again, I don't do episodes on it simply because I don't think I can add anything special that someone hasn't already said about it. From the, like I said, from the acting to the pacing to the color palettes to the camera angles, all of these things had its purpose. So when it comes down to this cartoon of Slip and Jimmy, the show has absolutely nothing to do with the stories in the actual universe, and they certainly don't share the same fan base, because I have not met a single Breaking Bad fan that likes this cartoon. I don't know who this was for or why. I think Peter Gould might have given it the okay, and I don't understand why. It was just such a bad show. And with so many characters in this modern era being so empty and shallow, it makes you ask, you know, what is comedy anymore? You know, like, it honestly has you puzzled on what happened to comedy, and filming itself making this topic even more puzzling in the case where the elephant in the room has a name and it's Slippin' fucking Jimmy. It's this terrible fucking thing. The show has absolutely nothing to do with it. And so I wonder, what is it? Is this comedy? Is this satire? Is this like an anti-humor comedy? Is this supposed to be meta? I have no clue what it is intended to be and what the game plan here was. And then it makes me wonder, with a lot of these shows that don't know how to stick to a genre, maybe that actually is the game plan. Don't stick to a specific genre, so that way the plot and the script can find its own niche and then keep it, maybe. But that's like watching a drunk being passed around because no one wants to be the shoulder to slob on. So that drunk is just being passed around from person to person until what? Till someone takes them home and murders it? Is that the game plan for the show? That seems to be the only fair way out for Slip and Jimmy, is honestly a murder. It's this new form of anti-genre excuses that don't know what they are and have no faith in themselves, so no genuine fan base. Reality television is garbage within itself, but at least they know who's watching it. I would like to fight this type of mindless, pointless crap before we get to the point where we're actually watching Ass the movie. If you've ever seen Idiocracy, you know what I'm talking about. So, like, we watched the Oscars not too long ago, and there was something that Jimmy Kimmel had said that just stuck with me, and I've had this bad taste in my mouth ever since. And, give it once. Now, he said something to the effect of, this guy, he said, this year you got to show your art the way that it was originally intended to be seen in theaters. And then the spineless celebrity flock goes on with their little golf claps. And this comment, now I have no problem with Jimmy Kimmel, but I'm just saying the very comment itself was made with no ill intent, and I know he meant the COVID issues, but when you look at the COVID issues and the aftermath of all of this, I'm in the great city of Chi-Town, and we lost every major North Side theater that I had grown up with since the 90s, from Lincoln Village, Lowe's Cineplex, Plaza Theater. We used to have 3 theaters and 2 arcades, a batting cage, and a mini golf course, all within the same 1-block plaza. It was about the size of a football field. And more down the street, not a single theater remains out of that entire plaza now. If you go there, it's a ghost town. And there's nothing there. I think there's a car wash, and they changed everything else for like a Home Depot and stuff. And then there used to be the Davis, which was a theater over on Lincoln near Montrose. And the Davis would charge you $1.50 to see the first showing. And then it would be $2.50 after that. And the movies were kind of like the films that were going to be on in your VHS collection soon anyway. But, you know, just before they'd go, you know, to the DVDs, they would send them to the Davis just before that. Sometimes even after it. Like, I've seen movies that were now available at Blockbuster, but I'd still be watching it in the theater. I remember the only like movie that they had that was modern was when they finally got Bride of Chucky when it came out. And the line was like 2 blocks long. But we loved that place. And it was, you know, $4 for what was called a Davis art flick, which usually was like the artsy fartsy kind of movies. But popcorn was $1.25 up to $5. Now, I understand these stories normally come out of like very old people, but this was not a long time ago. This was just 2000. And by the end of the year in 2020, the number of movie theaters in America, I'm saying in America, opened by market share had fallen 38%. So here lies my problem. Now, once we start getting back to normal, or once we started getting back to normal, we lost so many things due to poor business, or they couldn't keep up with the rent anymore. And, you know, I can understand that for the mom and pop joints, but Panera Breads and, you know, stuff like that didn't add up. You know, they make a lot of money. So, you know, now we get a little slack and we get these little checks, those stimulus checks to help the economy, to get us back to doing shit. But the theaters didn't come back. They never did. And some only came back when it was relied on taxpayer money to open these theaters up again. Now, Hollywood does not need our fucking tax money. And if you want us to go back to theaters and watch them the way that you want us to, okay. How about the film companies that have so much money they can pay The Rock 7 figures to do 2 hours of a movie? I think you can afford to open your own fucking theaters and let us come in and enjoy it. That way you could even lower the prices of the tickets. Maybe more people will come. And, you know, we'll enjoy the movies you wanted us the way you intended, you know? Imagine that there's just a theater called the, you know, Touchstone Pictures Theater. And, you know, they can have over certain like midnight showings of Nightmare Before Christmas, or, you know, these ways to get kids back in the theater. You can do it. It's very simple. But it's not going to happen when you're forcing the taxpayers, us, to fucking pay for it. why don't you invest in it and then we will come? I mean, shit. If you build it, they will come. That's your business that came up with that fucking that quote, man. That's not Nostradamus talking. That's James Earl Jones from Field of Dreams, man. If you build it, they will come. So theaters should have been smarter from the get-go on how to run their business. For example, how about, I don't know, outsourcing or selling off your food, so that way it's all owned by Coca-Cola. So that means they pay for the concessions, and therefore they make the money off the concessions. So you would have like three different companies in one theater all getting money, but again, you would be able to lower prices and open more buildings. Does that make sense to anyone, or is this just, am I fucking insane? Because honestly, you could even do this with schools. Recently, in Minnesota, the mayor had signed off, the governor of Minnesota now, not Jesse Ventura, but the new one, he already signed off a bill that's offered free lunch for every kid in a public school in Minnesota. And that makes fucking sense. And honestly, what I never said with the schools, you could also do the same kind of process with the cafeterias to make more money for the schools. Use the conglomerates, you know, take advantage of them. Let them have a certain stake in your cafeteria. And as long as you get your piece, that money can go to school funding, the building, it can go to staff, it goes to students' benefits, you can get more books, you can get more computers. So if you want us to come to these great places, build us one, you cheap fucking bastards, okay? Hollywood has to be the most penny-pinching bunch of assholes. And I'm not going to, anyone that's going to say, oh, that's a Jewish thing. Seriously, come on, man. Greed is not a Jewish tradition, okay? It's an American, it's a human trait. I'm sorry, not American. It's a human trait. Greed is, okay? That's why it's a sin, all right? It's been around for a while. So I don't want to hear any of that crap about Jews owning Hollywood. That makes no goddamn sense, man. You knew that the Italians owned most of the fucking Teamsters. That's why fucking, you know, my people, Italian mobsters, were funding those shitty-ass Steven Seagal movies. And that's right, his name is Steven Seagal. It's not Steven Seagal. He can go suck a dick. His name is Steven Seagal, and he still sucks. And he's a fat, fascist, horrible human being that is just, you know, the pick of the litter when it comes to garbage people, okay? I'm going to do a whole freaking one on that tomorrow, just because I'm pissed about it. But, yeah, so in summation, if these money-loving Hollywood executives want us to see the movie the way the directors intended to, then build us the theaters. You can afford it. You're freaking Hollywood. All right. And guess what? You build it, we will come. All right. That's my time. Thank you for spending it with me. Always appreciate it. Just do yourselves a favor and do me a favor. Stay peaceful, stay safe, stay sane. And most of all, stay cheesy, my friends. And I will see you on the other side.
Please note these are a form of social commentary and not in any way meant to put down the ideas and ideals of any political or gender identity. You are all fair game in the eyes of the wicked, and we see you. Here we go. Here we go. Here we go. Here we go.
Oh, shit! I'm Pickle Rick! You are now watching Useless Gaming episode 32. Best 2S.
one that might be. This is not a new world. It is simply an extension of what began in Poland. It has patterned itself after every dictator who has ever planted the written imprint of Booth on the face of history since the beginning of time.
Dog will hunt.
Fuck, suck, and eat butt.
Stupid.
Yeah, what? Very stupid.
Welcome to the desert of the real.